My name is John Vanhouten, with Hill City Assembly of God, staff pastor there under Pastor James Rugg. Jamie got a hold of me last year and he asked me to speak today on unsportsmanlike conduct, avoiding the drive killers. And I've had many drive killers in my life, and I'm sure all of you have as well. If you haven't, come and talk to me and tell me what your secret is, because even still today I have drive killers, and 99.999% of the time it's my fault. So, you know, that's the biggest thing that we got to remember as men, is a lot of it's not God saying, you know, I'm going to bring this against you and you have to deal with it. You know, too many times we blame God, and God's not, he's there to pick us up when we fall down, when we fall in the traps that we get into. Today I wanted to look at 2 Samuel chapter 11, and this chapter here, if you're familiar with it, it's the downfall of David, King David and Bathsheba. You know, as men, you know, we have all different opportunities, especially in this world. Doesn't matter, where we are, we run into problems, we run into issues. The drive killing penalties that we run into, some are made in the spur of the moment, some are made out of our own stupidity, and some we know are wrong and we still do it anyway. It's just the nature of the flesh. You look at the Super Bowl this year, with Atlanta and New England. In that second half, all Atlanta had to do was get that field goal. You know, they marched the ball down there, they got within field goal range, and then what happened? Boom, their first penalty. You know, they were great all game. They looked excellent. And, they were killing them. And they got that first penalty. They lined up for the next play. Second penalty. What happened? That put them out of field goal range. So they got up for the third play. Now they had to go for it. And next thing that happens, the quarterback sack. That took them out of the game. They were done. New England comes back. We've seen it. You know, they tied it up. And they ended up winning. You know, as men, we do the exact same thing in life. We get comfortable. We get lazy. We get prideful. We get cocky. And, we get that feeling that we can handle anything, that we can do anything, that I'm invincible, that it doesn't matter, that I can play right to the last moment. I can get right to the edge and then jump back into safety. And too often we do that. And that's what happened to one of the greatest men in the Old Testament, King David. King David was known for two things: his heart for God and his downfall with Bathsheba. It starts off, and I'm going to kind of ad-lib it, it starts off, David, it was springtime and they were supposed to go out to war, to battle. And in those times, the king always led their army into battle. And this time, David decided to appoint somebody to do it. Mm-hmm. So David appoints Joab to take out the army of Israel and go. Now, David is 55 years old around this time. He's been king over Israel for about 20 years. And, we see as guys, the only thing, that affects us, David being where he was in his position, David got laxed. David got where it was too much of a bother, I believe. And so David appointed somebody else to go in his place. The army went, the Ark of the Covenant went, the king always, went and led there, the army, and David decided to stay home. And, the decision that he made that day turned out to haunt him. Just like us, the decisions that we make today and the situations that we're faced with are going to be, it's going to determine the outcome of your tomorrow, of your families tomorrow. You know, us as men, God set it up that we're the head of the house. We're the head of our family. And, you know, when we make decisions, yeah, we shouldn't make them lightly. Because when we make that decision and that judgment falls on us when we're wrong, it falls on your wife, it falls on your children, it falls on generations to follow. So it's important that we are, you know, in line with God. You know, so David sent the armies off. Like I said, it was David's job to lead them in the battle. And, you know, King David stayed back, and he wasn't where he was supposed to be. You know, he was basically the beginning of the end for him. And this is where the downfall turned. Like I said, he got lazy. He got displacing. And, you know, so that was his first mistake. And he didn't even realize it. You know, he made that first mistake of staying home, staying back. And that opened the door. That opened the door for the enemy. And he didn't even realize. And the same with us today. You know, we might do something that seems so innocent in our eyes, but yet God says, I called you to do this. And we decide we're going to go do this. And even though it looks innocent to us, that opens the door for the enemy. It just cracks the door, just a hair. And, you know, so that was the progression that started right there. And it started out very light. And that was his first mistake. You know, God gives us, you know, he has a plan for each and every one of us. And he has it laid out. And God knows, because if we get idle, God knows that our minds, the way they're designed, if we get idle, it leads to wandering desires. And that's what happened here. You know, David, we see King David, you know, in verse 2, he's lying around. You know, everybody's out to battle. It's just him, you know, and his servants in the palace. And, you know, he's not sleeping very good. So what does he do? He gets up and goes for a walk on his roof. And, you know, as he's walking on, you know, the patio, it kind of overlooks the city down below him. That's when he spots her. He sees Bathsheba sitting up on the roof, you know, bathing. You know, so she's up there taking a bath. And so being a guy, what does David do? You know, we've all, everybody in this room has seen somebody walking down the road. You know, you're at the mall. You've seen, you know, a beautiful woman walk by, you know, dressed a little provocatively. And what do? Do you look away? You know, you know, God designed us to be, you know, attracted to the physical. But we have a responsibility to what we're looking at. So, you know, as I was growing up courting my wife, you know, I was attracted physically to her. You know, now that I'm married, you know, I'm still attracted to her, but that's where my focus should be. And, you know, it's important that us guys, you know, keep that in mind. You know, so David was laying around and he seen her up on the roof. And, you know, he goes for that walk and he's seeing her. Like I said, he's bored. He's just kind of doing his thing. And I was watching Monster Garage. I don't know if you've ever seen that. It's where they take a car, they, you know, strip it down, they do whatever challenge they have, and Jesse James is the one that does it. And he said a quote in there, and, you know, it hit me. It was perfect with what I'm looking at. He said, an idle mind is the devil's playground. So when you're sitting there idle, when you're sitting there not doing, you know, what you're supposed to be doing, when you're not where you're supposed to be when God calls you, you know, you're sitting idle. And the devil loves that. If he can get you to get frustrated, if he can get you to get lazy and laxed, that's when he starts to do his business. So, you know, I believe that's where David was at. You know, he was sitting at home. He was letting everybody else take care of, you know, what he was supposed to be doing. And, you know, David seeing her, and instead of turning and walking away, he stopped and he stared. You know, how many times have we been going through the channels, you know, at home? You've been through 350 channels. You know there's nothing on, but you go back through them again. and all of a sudden you come across a Victoria's Secret commercial. You know, what do you do? How many of you guys turn the, turn it real quick? So, no, 99.9% of us stop and we watch the commercial. And then after the commercial, we'll go back and continue surfing. You know, same thing with the internet. You know, you can be on there, and I've searched the internet, searching for certain things. And you gotta be careful what you put in the Google search anymore, because they tie things with everything. And you could be looking at something innocent, and then on the side, something will pop up. You know, a photograph or a picture. It's in that moment, what do? You know, the flesh wants you to click on it. The flesh wants you to proceed with it. But being a man of God, we got to turn from that and run from it. So, that was the second mistake David made. You know, the longer we stare, the longer we take in the situation, the longer we take in the sin, the harder it's going to be to resist it, to tempt it. The harder it's going to be to walk away. You know, the more that gets etched in your mind. And like I said, us with God, being guys, we are programmed to the physical. So when we see something, my wife can tell me 150 different things, and I won't remember one thing. But she shows me, go and get this. And she shows me a picture of it. I can go and have 47 other things going on and know exactly what she wants. Because we're designed to, be physical, to see the physical. So, the more we stop and stare at that picture, the more we, look at that screen, the more we look at that woman out there, the harder it is to get it out of our minds. David, in that moment, should have turned and walked away. There should have been no second glances. There should have been no second guessing it. So David takes it a step further. In verse 3, he sends a servant down to get the down low on her. He didn't know who she was. All he knew is that she was beautiful and that he had to have her. So David basically, sent his servant to acquire. In today's days, we would Google her. And, David could have ended the temptation by leaving the scene. Even after entertaining, he still had that chance to get away. But he went the next step. He started looking into the situation. And even the servant realized it. So David put himself into a more tempting situation. And the servant came back. And the servant himself, the way it's written, in verse 4, 3 and 4, he says, "Is this not Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam?" Now, Eliam was one of David's mighty men. So one of his warriors that was out fighting, it was her daughter. And so that was, number one. David crossed the line there because he decided it didn't matter. Even though that was one of his men that was loyal to him, it didn't matter. So, so she was from the upper class. Her father was Eliam, one of David's mighty men, and that's in 2 Samuel 23:34. Her grandfather was Othello, and I'm not 100% sure if I'm saying that right, but, he was one of David's chief priests, or chief counselors. So that's someone even up higher. This is someone David would go to for counsel. It's his granddaughter. And that's in 2 Samuel 23:34 and 2 Samuel 15:12. So these two men, this is her father and grandfather, were loyal to David, and David didn't care. When your blood's boiling, there's nothing that's going to change or get in your way in a situation like that. Talk about the game changers. And then you come to, then he says, this is the wife of Uriah the Hittite. Right there, strike three. David should have, at that point, it's somebody's wife, number one. Uriah, one of the men that's out in the field right now battling for David, who's sitting at home on his butt. You know, this is stuff that, you know, we got to watch as men. Because, it, like I said, it started out so innocently. David decided to stay home. And what happened? It snowballed into this effect. You know, how many of you guys have ever been out? You know, it's fall. You know, your wife's on you. You go out there and rake the leaves, get rid of them. So it's a little damp out. You get out there, you rake them all up. You know, it's big game coming on later. You know, there's something that you want to do. And you know this is going to take time. And you try and light them. You know, you get a gigantic pile of paper and pile it on there. And you try and light them. And, you know, the paper and everything burns. And then the leaves kind of smolder out. So you're standing there. You look up at your time. And you want to get on. You want to get in and get ready for the game. So in our male build, you know, we're thinking in our minds, you know, we're determined to get this done. We're determined to get it done fast. You know, we start getting aggravated. We start thinking irrationally. So what do?
Pour gasoline on it.
We go out to the shed, grab the gas can. You take that, and yeah, my father-in-law's laughing. I burnt his backyard down once. But you take that, and you know, we pour a little bit on there, not thinking that that paper was burning, and there's, you know, some embers in the bottom of it. And then all of a sudden, what happens?
You have no eyebrows.
All you smell is your eyebrows. That's why I have no hair. You know, David was in this situation. You know, David, he stayed home. He seen Bathsheba on the roof. You know, so the amber was smoldering. You know, he sends and he inquires about her. You know, they come back, they tell her all who she is. And, you know, the next thing, you know, David starts desiring her. David's trying to figure out how to get her. So he sends for her. And, you know, he brings him to her house, or brings her to his house. And, you know, that's when the ignition happened. David poured the gas all over it, and it blew up. There was the one-night stand. It happened. Mm-hmm. You know, if David would have been where he was supposed to be, this would have never happened. Mm-hmm. So, you know, he can't blame anybody. Mm-hmm. And too often we end up blaming God. We end up blaming, you know, our spouses. We end up blaming our family, our buddies, our friends. Well, I was hanging with them, they made me do it. And, you know, too often we don't look at ourselves. You know, as guys, we have to look at ourselves and ask the question. Like, you know, Pastor Don this morning said, you know, what kind of a man are you? You see, in today's standard, you know, in the worldly standard today, the world says to go and satisfy your needs. And there's a difference between a need and a desire. Too often we think our needs are needs, when actually our needs are desires. You know, a need is actually food, water, you know, clothing. You know, that's a need, necessity to survive. But too often we put our desires in that category. You know, we say, well, I need to, you know, have sex. I need to you know, drink alcohol. I need to go party here. I need to look at pornography. I need. When it's not need, it's desire. Yep. And it's all through our flesh. And today's standard, the worldly view of it says it's okay. They say go satisfy yourself. Take care of yourself. And you know, get it over with. You know, David committed adultery not only in his heart, but he actually followed through with it. And, you know, if we go by Jesus' standards, you know, in Matthew, he talks about anybody that looks at a woman and thinks about it, you've already committed the sin of adultery. So think about that. Every time you guys are, and even myself included, look at an image on the computer, look at an image on a commercial, in a movie, you know, a woman walking by, you know, we've already taken that too far. And we're in that situation. You know, when desire meets opportunity, there's going to be failure. When we're in the wrong place at the wrong time, there's going to be failure. I don't care what it is. I don't care if it's, sexual adultery, pornography, alcohol, gambling, money, idolization, anything. When our desire meets the opportunity, there's going to be failure. And that's our desire. That's not what God has planned for us. That's not our need. So we got to be careful with that. Once again, David wasn't supposed to be there. And this is a man that was supposedly after God's own heart. This was a man that did great things for God. So David carried out the affair. If we look at the example at Joseph was tempted by Potiphar's wife. And each time he was tempted, he fled. And, Joseph was on the other end of the spectrum here. David went after her. Joseph was being sought after. So it was harder for him. And so David, being in that situation, he could have went through with it. Joseph, he could have went through with it. Would anybody have known? Who knows? But God would know. Joseph stuck through that, and Joseph ran. But David did the opposite. David went seeking. David's seen that. He's seen her, and he had a desire for her, so he went seeking. It's better to run than reason. Once you start getting into a situation, you start reasoning, you're in trouble. You start justifying why what's going on, or why she looks good, or why I should do this. That's time to put the brakes on and step back and say, whoa, wait a minute. It's not a bad thing to run from temptation. In fact, the Bible tells us to. In 2 Timothy 2:2, it says, flee also youthful lust, but pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace. Those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. So flee youthful lust. The command is so simple. Flee youthful lust. Do not entertain it. Do not challenge them. Do not try and endure them. How many of us have been in a situation and we've thought in our mind, I'll just test myself. I know I can go so far and then, jump back. How many of us have done that? I know I've been there. David looked at Bathsheba and he said, beauty. But God saw it as ugly. The picture of sin deceives us like a bait that's hidden on the hook. And that's how Satan works. He hides. He hides the sin, and he tries to cover it up so we don't see it out front. We must call it what it is. God calls it sin. We want to say affair, but God says adultery. We want to say love, but God says lust. We want to say sexy, but God says it's sin. We want to say it's romantic, but God says it's ruin. We want to say it's destiny, but God says it's destruction. This destroyed David's integrity. And he had to live with that for the rest of his life. That one night stand destroyed everything that he had. David, in that, it gets worse. David, in that situation, Bathsheba ends up finding out that she's pregnant. She sends word to David. So David's trying to figure out what to do now. So David sends out and calls Uriah home. At this point, David had the option of either confessing or covering it up. Unfortunately, he tried to cover it up. So David calls Uriah home, and verses 6 through 14, by trying to cover up his sins. He gets Uriah to come home, and he starts with the small talk. Ask him how the war's going, how things are going out there, and later on, that afternoon, he says, well, you've been out there for a while, why don't you go home, clean up, spend the evening with your wife. Because he figured, Uriah's been out in the field, sleeping with a group of guys that are sweaty, smelly, and he figures, David will come home, or Uriah will come home, sleep with his wife, and then that'll cover up, they'll think it's Uriah's child. And, you know, you think that would be so easy. So, you know, David sent him home, and the only problem is Uriah didn't go home. He stayed on the outer quarters of his house. He slept with the servants. So that morning, his servant came and told him, you know, I could just picture David walking around that night too, you know, all puffed out and proud. This is going to be all over. It's going to be taken care of. You know, so often like we do, you know, we think we can get away with something. We do something, we think we get away with it. And then all of a sudden, you know, reality hits. And we realize we just made it worse. And that's what happens here. So his servant comes back and says, yo, David, Uriah never went home last night. He slept right outside your doors. So now, you know, David's starting to panic a little bit. You know, so how many of us get in that situation where we think we got it all straightened out, and then all of a sudden we get that curveball thrown at us? It's too often we fall into that trap. You know, but the sin didn't stop there. You know, the web that the enemy wants us to get entrapped in continues to grow. And you know, so after Uriah, David ended up approaching him and talked to Uriah. Said, you know, asked, why did you not go home with your wife? You know, David's trying to cover everything up in his mind. He's trying to figure out what's going on here. And I love the response Uriah gives in verses 10 and 11. You know, Uriah is more of a godly man right now than David is, which is hard to believe, with everything that David accomplished, with all the stuff he did with God. All of a sudden, it's like, you know, the light was turned off in David's life. And, you know, the response that Uriah gives, you know, Uriah stood loyal to the king. You know, Uriah is saying here in verses 10 and 11, I'm going to read that. David says, so why then, David's saying, Uriah, did you not go down to your house? Did you not come from a journey? And why did you not go down to your house? And Uriah said to David, the ark and Israel and Judah are dwelling in tents, and my lord Joab and the servants of my lord are encamped in open fields. Shall I then go to my house, eat, drink, lie with my wife? As you live, and as your soul lives, I will not do these things. So, you know, Uriah was basically saying to David, I learned the value of the presence of God from you. You know, I watched you. You know, where the ark is, that's where the presence of God is. You know, where is the ark in this situation?
In the field.
The ark is out in the field. David's left back at the house by himself. You know, so what's the connection here?
Huh.
You know, you walk away from God,
huh,
that's when the enemy's coming at you the hardest. That's when you're going to fall the hardest. You know, so David was away from God's presence, and that's when he fell. You know, so it's important as men that we keep an eye on where we are with God. We should have him in the focus the whole time. We should be running to him all the time. And too often we get distracted. And we get distracted easily. And, you know, it's in those situations we need the Spirit. You know, when you feel him tugging, you better take a look at what's going on. So, in verses 12 and 13, again, David has another chance to confess. Well, what does he do? He's trying to figure out, his wheels are turning, what can I do now? You know, Uriah is faithful to David, to the army, to God. And he's not going to go and pleasure himself and fulfill his desires when his duty is out in the field, when his duty is fighting on the front lines. So David's thinking, well, how about we get him a little good and drunk? You know, it's worked with Noah. It worked with Samson. You know, why not give it a shot here? You know, how many of us have been out, had a good time, had a little too much to drink, not remember, you know, what happened the next morning or how we got in the situation? So that's what David was thinking. You know, there's hardly a man that can withstand sexual temptation when juiced up. You know, when you get all intoxicated and under that false spirit, you know, you'll do whatever your body, whatever your flesh wants you to do. So that's what David tried to do. So David gets him all drunked up, and then he tries to send him home again. And Urias ends up staying once again outside David's quarters, or his the front of his palace with his servants. And it didn't work. You know, Urias stood to his morals. He stood to his convictions. You know, verse 18 through 27, David takes the next step. He realized he can't get him to sleep with his wife, so how is he going to cover this sin up? So now David gets a hold of Joab out in the field, and he calls him in, or he sends a letter to him that Uriah is carrying, and he says, put him on the front lines. You know, so he wants to assassinate him. So David hires Joab to do that for him. And so he throws him out in the front lines, he pulls all the army back, and Uriah gets killed. So not only has David committed adultery, not only has he coveted, you know, his neighbor's wife. There's about 8 commandments David broke here within this passage. You know, now he murdered. So now he's got the blood of Uriah on his hands because he's the one that ordered it. And I encourage you to read the rest of the chapter. Because David thought he was done. David thought he was over. He thought he got out of it until chapter 12 came along, and the prophet came back to him. And the situations we get ourselves in that we think we're clear of, you know, God knows, and God's out there, and he's going to send somebody. It might not be today, it might not be tomorrow, but some way, somehow, you know, it's going to come back to you, and you're going to wish then that it didn't happen. By then, it's too late. You know, basically, so how does this apply to us? You know, I just kind of gave you the story of what David did. You know, he had it all. He had the kingdom. He had the fear of the armies. He had the fear of all the other, you know, countries around him. He had presence of God on his side, no matter what he did, just as long as God was with him, he was victorious, until he stepped away from God. So, you know, I have 3 things here. Number one, I am not above this. You know, the lesson here, you know, God is saying, you know, greater men have fallen than I have. You know, like I was explaining, look at where David was. Look at all the accomplishments he accomplished. Look at all the favor that God had on him. And he still turned. You know, Satan still got in there and turned his heart from God. You know, if King David fell, what makes me think that I'm above that? You know, there's not one of us that's above this kind of sin. You know, this collapse of faith, you know, this collapse of moral character and failure. You know, it's not monsters and perverts that fall to sin. It's godly men. You know, it's each one of us that fall to sin. So it's important that we don't walk around thinking that we're better than that. That can never happen to us. Number 2, sexual sin is an inside job. You know, the lesson here is that of a man that fell, you know, David was not out of sexual options. David had 8 wives, and he had countless concubines. You know, why did he have to go and do what he did with Bathsheba? Why did he have to cross that line? Mm-hmm. You know, what's the point? You know, David's heart lusted. You know, David had a desire like all men, but he let that desire get out of line. You know, in James 1, 12 through 15, it says, blessed is the one who preserves under trial, because having stood the test, that person will receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised to those who love him. When tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. But each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desires and enticed. Then after desires has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death. This is literally the situation David was in. You know, David sinned with Bathsheba. You know, the baby was born. And if you read further, that was one of the things God took the baby from them. You know, because of David's sin, you know, that life was taken out. And too often we end up blaming God for our situations that we get into. And like it says here, God is not going to tempt you. He's going to, you know, you'll have trials to go through. But God is not going to tempt you. The enemy is the tempter. Satan is the tempter. You know, he's the one that's going to bring, you know, obstacles against you. He's going to try and get you to trip up and fall. And it's important that we recognize those situations. We discern between them. And then the third thing is choose your environment wisely. Mm. You know, David was in the wrong place at the wrong time. Mm. Young and old, it doesn't matter. You know, choose wisely. A great man in the wrong place at the wrong time royally screwed up. You know, it's hard to do the right things in the wrong place. You know, when kings go to battle, David didn't. If David would have went to battle where he was supposed to be, this would have been avoided. You know, the rest of David's reign would have been, I believe, you know, twice as prosperous as what he went through already. Mm-hmm. You know, David had a horrible failure. You know, he thought he got away with it. You know, if David thought about this, he would have seen the cost. If he would have taken a second and stepped back, you know, he would have seen the cost was much greater than what that one night meant. You know, because of this, David got an unwanted pregnancy. David murdered a trusted friend. There was a baby that died because of it. His daughter was raped by his son. One son murdered another son. A civil war was led by one of his other sons. And the son who imitated David's lack of self-control and that led him to much of Israel and led much of Israel away from God. And, you know, that was Samuel there. And, you know, it was because of his desire to have so many, you know, wives and so many women that he started falling to the idolization. You know, he started giving in to the temptations. And, you know, that led to the fall of Israel. You know, technology today makes it so easy. You know, we got computers out there. You know, I can remember when I grew up, and the reason that this is, you know, so close to me is, you know, I was involved in pornography heavy for a long time. And it nearly destroyed my life. You know, I don't know why it didn't destroy my marriage, but my wife stood with me. And, you know, she helped me through a lot of it. You know, when I grew up, it was just magazines. And, you know, then you had the hotlines that came along. You know, and then the computer came along, and the internet, the dial-up. And then you had broadband and high-speed internet. And now you got your cell phones. You know, the world says, you know, too often we say, I'm not strong enough to do this. God's not strong enough to do this, is what we're saying. You know, if we're men of God, that's what we're saying. We're saying the world is greater or the world is greater than God, that I can't get away from this temptation. When all we got to do is turn and run to God. It's not that we can't get rid of it or we can't get away from it. It's we don't want to give it up. And that's what it comes down to. You know, the word says, greater is he that lives in me than he that is in the world. Yeah. You know, so why do we say that, God, you're not stronger than my lust or my sexual desires or my idolization or my drinking or my gambling or my sin? You know, God is above all that. The problem is we got to release it. Mm-hmm. You know, 82% of guys in this room have come across pornography in their lives. Mm-hmm. You know, 40% seek it regularly. You know, in 2004, there was research done in Europe. 5.8% of men were dealing with erectile dysfunction in 2004. And these are young men. 2 years later, 2006, it jumped to 30%. And the change of that was our computers went from dial-up to high speed. So now the pornography was more available, it was quicker, it was, you know, higher quality. And, you know, in 2014, an average of 25-year-old guys were done in this study. 58% of them were dealing with erectile dysfunction with women. Mm-hmm. But you put a computer screen in front of them, and they were... And why is that? Because we trained our brains to look at that image, to look at that computer screen, instead of looking at our wives and saving everything that God intended it to be with our wives in the bedroom. So it's important. It's important that, you know, we don't get into the situations like that. And it's just like a drug addiction. You know, the more you look at it, the more you do it, the more you want it, the more desire. You know, gambling is the same way. The more you gamble, you want more and more and more. It doesn't matter. Alcohol. You know, any type of drug addiction, any type of, idolatry, anything like that, money, things of this world, anything you can get hooked on. You know, it's not just pornography. That's just, you know, the story was the example, but it can be anything. And what I ask you guys today, as I close here, Proverbs 28:13 says, he who covers his sin will not prosper, but he who confesses and forsakes it, they will have mercy. So if you're running around thinking you can cover up what you're doing, it's going to, you're not going to have that mercy. You know, God's not going to answer your prayers. Every time you call out and ask him to take something from you, take this desire from me, you know, he can't do it because you're not willing to give it up. You're not willing to confess it. You're not willing to truly repent of it. So that's what David did here. He was trying to cover up his sins. And because of that, all the prosperity stopped. And then he lived the rest of his days with that. What happened? He lived by the sword. He lived through all the situations that happened to his family. You know, so today is a new day. Today, if you're in a situation like that, I challenge you, young and old, doesn't matter age, the devil don't care. He wants to get you. It doesn't matter where you are, who you're with, you know, his desire is to get you to fall. So today I encourage you, you know, talk to somebody. And don't go to your buddies, you know, that are doing the same thing as you. I want you to find somebody that's a godly man. You know, talk to your pastor. You know, talk to, you know, some of the guys in your church. Talk to the guys you know that are living for God. And too often that's what we do. We go looking for the answer that we want. So, you know, I encourage you as I close here today to, seek out, not only your pastor, you know, not only for yourself. You know, seek out other men out there that are going through this situation. You know, you hear who's in trouble and who's doing what. You know, as guys, we're not going to come right out and you know, start talking about things. We're just not built that way. We'd rather take things and jam it down inside and continue living the way we live. So, you know, I encourage you today. And you know, if you're into it that deep, where you think it's gonna, you know, hurt your marriage, or your wife isn't gonna understand, or somebody's not gonna understand, get in the atmosphere of, you know, your pastor. You know, talk it out with him first. Work it step by step, because God will restore it. You know, nothing you've done is bad enough that God cannot do it. So I'm going to close here in prayer, and we're going to move on to our next session. You got 15 minutes, 11:30, the next one starts, I believe. Yes. So, Father God, Lord, I come to you today, and I thank you for the opportunity to speak to these men. Lord, these are your men. Father God, I pray that you'll touch each one in this place, each one in this event today, not only in this room, but outside this room, Father God. Let them see that you have a desire to love on them, to forgive them, to restore them, Father God. I just pray that you'll touch their minds, touch their hearts, Lord. And if there's somebody that is struggling and that doesn't know you, Father God, I pray that they will come to know you today, Lord. I pray that the addiction, the temptation, everything stops here. And Father God, I ask in the mighty name of Jesus for your face and favor to shine upon us. We ask this in Jesus' name.